Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, whose glory is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word, Jesus Christ, your Son, with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read together Psalm 121, found in your bulletin. We will read responsively, whole verse by whole verse. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved, and he who watches over you will not fall asleep. Behold, he who watches over Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord himself watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. So that the sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. It is he who shall keep you safe. The Lord shall watch over your going out and your coming in, for this is the time forevermore. Our second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the inherent of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, and where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believes, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now, there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things, you do not believe. How can you believe if I tell you about earthly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, St. Michael's.
Good morning,
teacher. Yes. As many of you are aware, today we are doing our annual meeting during the announcements. So our worship is going to look a little bit differently than it typically would on a normal kind of every week Sunday. And as part of that, I'm not really going to give a full-fledged sermon or homily, just a very brief little reflection, and I'm going to have more to say a little bit later. But one thing I can't really help myself but mention about this gospel, because it is, like many of them, are just so good, is something I want to highlight about this exchange that happens between Jesus and Nicodemus, which is fascinating in and of itself. Something I want to highlight is what they're talking about in the terms of being born again. Because that phrase, being born again, particularly within our culture, context, within our society, it has a lot of weight to it, right? It's a phrase that we hear so often from time to time again, being born again. And the word that's used here in the original Greek, that can mean, you know, actual birth, that's of bringing a child into the world. But that's not the only meaning that that word has, which is important, I think, for us to highlight. That word can also mean a kind of healing or regrowth, right? A profound healing that can take place. If you imagine, if you take a starfish and you cut it in half, how it grows into a whole new thing. The word in Greek could mean something similar to that, something new coming into being. And at this point, which we'll hear in our annual meeting in a little bit, we as a community are becoming something new, which is wonderful. We are growing in and redeveloping, re-becoming. It's a thrilling time to be here and to be part of this community, and I'm excited. So like I said, I'm not really giving a homily, just a quick little reflection, and we'll hear more at the announcements when we do the actual business of the church at the annual meeting. So, amen. Together, let us stand and proclaim the words of our faith as found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Jesus Christ intercedes for us at all times. Together, let us remember and pray to God through Christ, saying, "Have mercy, O Lord." For the church, that the fasting of these 40 days may clear away much that is needless, and so open our eyes to the bright glory of the cross, we pray, "Have mercy, O Lord." For the church and those baptized at Easter will learn from us to read and ponder and cherish the Scriptures. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Paul's Evansville, the Reverend Holly Rankin Zayer. We pray, "Have mercy, O Lord." For our divided and restless world, that those who hold power over others may be troubled and transformed by the demands of justice. We pray especially for Joe Biden, our president, Eric, our governor, Chris, our mayor, for the city of Noblesville. We pray,
have mercy, O Lord.
We pray for those serving in the military, Nahum Cook, Samantha Embers, Caleb Garrett, Tommy Harris, Brayton Harrison, Ken Morrison. We pray,
have mercy, O Lord.
For this gathered community, that the solemn brightness of Lent may open our eyes to these times, their folly and their worth. We pray,
have mercy, O Lord.
For those who have asked for our prayers, especially Grant Cook, Lydia Wente, Paige Sexton, Heather Duchess, Clint Hagen, Jen Hagen, Daryl Hartman, Ken Bush, Megan Leahy, Rachel Schoening, Emily Baker, Louise Hoff, and Thomas Megan. We pray,
have mercy, O Lord.
For the dead, especially for those who held to and handed on God's commandment until our day, that they may be at peace. Junior Connor. We pray,
have mercy, O Lord.
By your power, dear God, you raised Christ Jesus, and in him we too will be raised. Receive our prayers and those of all your saints, that trusting in you all the days of our lives, we may know the fullness of your love and the power of the resurrection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Together, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Amen. Mighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of peace with one another. Good morning, St. Michael's.
Good morning.
So as I mentioned, today is our annual meeting. Okay. I'm wondering if that's why we're a small crowd today. And just a quick word before we get started about why we're doing it right now. I prefer to do the annual meeting within the context of worship, kind of nestled by the liturgy of the word and the liturgy of the table for a couple reasons. The business of the church, the budget, the ministries, boards and everything, the election of the vestry, all of that happens within the context of worship, the true work of the church, which is worship. And in the midst of annual meetings, sometimes conversations get very animated or whatever, there might be disagreements, I'm not expecting any. But when there are, the beautiful thing about having an annual meeting in the middle of service is that after all of that, whatever, wherever we are, we all come together and we gather around the table of God and we break bread together as the family of Christ. So that's why we're doing it right now, not after or another point. So let's say a prayer and then we'll get into the agenda for today. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we come to you this hour asking for your blessing and help as we are gathered together. We pray for guidance in matters at hand and ask that you would clearly show us how to conduct our work with a spirit of joy and enthusiasm. Give us the desire to find ways to excel in our work. Help us to work together and encourage each other to excellence. We ask that we would challenge each other to reach higher and further to be the best that we can be. And we ask all of this in the name of our Savior, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So our first order of business is to elect a clerk to take minutes for this meeting. And we have had a nomination for Lori Shonan, who has been serving as our clerk. Right along. Do we have a second? Do we have a first nomination for Lori Shonan? Do we have somebody else as a second? And Rita in second. All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. And thank you, Lori, for doing this. Thank you. Our next order of business is to approve the minutes from last year's annual meeting. These were amended recently, so there is a white sheet of paper in your pink annual meeting bulletin. These are the minutes that we are looking at and approving. Are there any edits or comments, or is there a motion to approve the minutes as amended?
I make a motion. Or second it? Well, first it?
So, movements to approve the annual meetings in 2022 made by Megan, seconded by Julie. All in favor?
Aye.
Excellent. Just moving right along. Next order of business is the budget review of 2022 and 2023. So, I'm going to pass this over to Greg, our treasurer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Hey, I'm Greg Cowell. I'm your treasurer. I've been doing this the last probably 3 years if you've been here. And there was a gap, and I was doing it probably 10 years before that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to review my report directly comes out of the pink agenda that you received. Let's start out by reading what I wrote last year. So a year ago, our 22 budget shows that our expenses will exceed our income by $20,866. We need additional income to stay even and more to meet our aspirations to grow. Our facility also needs maintenance. Please continue with your support of time, talents, and treasure. So a year ago, we put together a budget that was $20,000 upside down. We were going to spend $20,000 more than we brought in. That's not sustainable. So now I'm going to look at the end of 2022, the beginning of 2023, and tell you I'm pleased to show at the end of 22, we have a larger cash reserve than we had at the end of 21 by about $10,000. This is going for... Well, it is pretty good.
We can applaud.
So we went from a projected deficit of $20,000 to a surplus of $10,000. So how do we do that? Okay, we took in $7,700 more than our budget in pledges and plate. So the congregation was very generous in their donations. We had a very successful strawberry festival. We came in $4,500 over budget on the strawberry festival. We didn't hire an administrator. We had planned on it. It was budgeted, but for a number of reasons, it just didn't work out. We did hire at the end of the year, the very end of the year, a sexton. So now we have a sexton. That's going to impact our budget this year, as I'm going to show you later on, but not by much. It's a very reasonable amount of money for what we're getting as far as keeping the building up. The combined budgeted amount for secretary last year saved us $20,000. So that's $20,000 of the $30,000 we were ahead. And that's all because of the generosity, or largely anyway, not all, I'm sorry, of Julie. Julie puts in a lot of hours. We did have something more headwinds. We had a furnace die, the Narthex heat pump. Now this is amazing. 2 years in a row we've had once a furnace downstairs and a heat pump upstairs, but we had very generous donations from the congregation and it covered it. So all in all, at the end of the year, we were ahead of where we were the prior year. Moving forward into this year, the 2023 budget, we show a similar but smaller deficit. We still are running a negative budget. We'll receive reduced support from the diocese. The diocese has a budget, like we do, for everything on supporting congregations. Because of the needs of the diocese, they've had to cut ours back a bit. So you'll see that I have a detail on later pages. We have no income from the Montessori school. Last year, the Montessori school informed us that they didn't have a viable business here, so they closed down in the spring. And so we lost that budgeted income. We're going to have a sexton. We're going to be spending money on a sexton for 12 months this year. And as I said before, that's pretty reasonable for what we're getting in the way of keeping the building up to snuff. We've given 3% raises to our rector and our organist. And our utilities are creeping up, just like yours at home. You see gas going up, electricity going up. We don't use a ton of gas. The lower level is heated with gas. This level is heated with electricity, but electricity has gone up as well. So we're expecting to see utilities continue to rise. So as a positive offset, we had a very, very successful pledge drive in the fall. At the end of the year, you were all part of it. And we're anticipating significant return at the Strawberry Festival this year based on last year's results. Yeah, I hope I've described this as a positive thing. We still can't honestly show it that we're going to come out ahead this year, but based on last year and hope for this year, we're going to be moving forward. The next page kind of shows where we are the column on the far right is the end of 2021. The one in the middle is the end of 2022. So we have one physical bank account. Okay. Last year we had two. The year before we had three when we were still closing up the fund drive. So when we paid off last year the building, we closed that checking account down. Last year, the Daughters of the King disbanded, I guess is the best word. And so we closed that checking account out. So we have one checking account. Now in that checking account, we've got a number of pockets where we keep different amounts of monies that we restrict for certain expenses. So mostly it's the operating account. So at this year, we have $157,727 at the beginning of the year in that checking account. Of that, $149,700 is set up for operating, basically, the things we need to keep the lights on and the heat on and pay salaries. Daughters of the King, like I told you, at $0 for this year. Youth, we had a little bit of income. I'm not sure right now off the top of my head where it came from, but there's a little money set aside for youth should we ever reactivate the youth group. Rector's discretionary fund, we had incomes and outgoes, but we're roughly the same as we were a year ago. The sacristy got a few more dollars this year, gifts directly for the sacristy. Now, I know I don't know what anybody else is going to say. I don't want to steal their thunder, but they are spending some of that sacristy money right now. We had the chalice that we use on a weekly basis is out east getting refurbished, and it looked like new when it comes back. Okay, we have, besides the checking account, we have another account. It's at Edward Jones' office in downtown Noblesville. Of that, we have the remainder of the Castor Fund. This is something that was donated to St. Michael's, I don't know, 40, 50 years ago from Worth Castor, the estate of Worth Castor. Okay, 82, yeah. And for a long time, that's helped St. Michael's out a lot. So we have about $7,300 in January left on that. We also have about $7,500 in Lilly stock. So the difference is we haven't spent any of the Castor Fund last year. So the difference at the end of 21 to 22 is strictly market fluctuations. That's why it's going up or down. Same with the Lilly stock. So at the bottom, you'll see at the end of 21, we had $161,000. The end of 22, we had 172,000. So we came ahead about $10,000 year over year. Okay, then on the next page is a form. It's similar to what I show the vestry every month, the statement of activities. But the top part shows all of our expected income for 2023, the budgeted amount. And I've compared that to last year's, both budgeted amount and actual amount, so you can compare them. I'm not going to cover all of them, but just the major items. $135,000 of our income is expected to be pledged, 10,000 plate. Strawberry Festival, 16,500. And that's kind of in line. Last year we got 19,000, so I think that's a safe number. And the diocese, they went from 22,500 in last year down to 17,500 this year. So it's getting a little tighter. If you get all the way down to the bottom, against a budgeted amount last year of 185,700, we're at 185,500. So almost the same income we're anticipating in 23 as 22, slightly different sources. Looking at expenses, and this is what we spend our money on. I'm just going to, again, hit the highlights. There's a rector's discretionary expense, $1,000. The amount of money we pay the diocese every month, that's a biggie. We pay the diocese an assessment every month, all the parishes do, and that's based on 3 years of operating revenue. So they do a number, it's a percentage of the average of 3 years. So that this year, that's $22,500. We spent last year $7,300 to put on the Strawberry Festival. So that's the cost, not the income. And this year we're planning on spending $8,200. That's been offset slightly by the gifts that we've gotten for the monthly brunches we're holding. That money's going to help us put on the Strawberry Festival this year. Conferences, that's mainly the Diocesan Convention, $1,000. What else? Or excuse me, $1,200. Outreach, $4,000. Last year, that's what we spent on proceeds from the Strawberry Festival. That chunk of that was used for outreach. Altar Guild, $3,500 for flowers, vestments, cleaning vestments, all the things the Altar Guild does. We budgeted $3,500. Then we get into salaries. What we pay the government in FICA for our lay employees, $2,800. Organist salary, $23,500 for this year. Rector salary, $62,500 for this year. Rector's pension, $13,000 for the year. And rector's CICA. CICA is about the same thing as FICA. It's for clergy as opposed to lay employees. And then a little bit more on the next page. It didn't all fit here. Electricity, $7,350. Gas, $1,200. Insurance, $6,300. We had this week a meeting with our insurance agent reviewing property insurance. That went real well. We look like we're in pretty good shape. We're kind of on the edge of maybe bumping it up a little bit, but otherwise it looks pretty good. Operating maintenance, $4,500. That'll work as long as we don't have another furnace go out. So I think we're in good shape. We have several furnaces. There's a long story behind it. We have a number of heat sources. Snow removal, $1,000. We've probably spent close to that already this year. It's expensive. We've cut back our snow clearing this year because we don't have a Montessori school. When they were here, we wanted to be real scrupulous in that, make sure we didn't have a problem. This year, there's not people coming and going 4 days a week. And then trash removal. So, expenses budgeted last year, $206,000. Expenses budgeted this year, $199,000. So we're about the same as we were expense-wise last year, too. We're planning. And that gives us a deficit of $13,000, almost $14,000, as opposed to the $20,000 last year.
So that's pretty much where we're at finance-wise.
Can I answer any questions? I went through that pretty quickly. That's it.
So the budget has already been approved by the vestry. Do we have a motion to receive the budget? Motion made by Rick to receive. Is there a second? Submitted by Janet. All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. That was smooth and easy. And I want to make a point to really thank Greg and Rick, the chair of our stewardship board, for all the hard work that they've done over the course of this last year and the last several years to get us to where we are. Because we've had, like every other church of our size across the country since the pandemic, we've had a number of financial challenges. And we still have challenges that are there, but not nearly as many as otherwise could have been there without their diligence and time, effort, and hard work. So big thank you to both of you. I recognize I'm doing things a little bit out of order on the agenda, so apologies for that. But at this time, Rick, if there's anything that you would like to add for your senior warrant report, I'd like to come forward and make your, I don't know what happens. Greg, do you have the microphone?
Oh, we don't need that.
Okay.
So here's the So this will be a little more business than spiritual. He's gotten used to that. You know, the round numbers from a state of the union standpoint, we're kind of like 40 pledging units. Cash in the bank is, as Greg mentioned to you, zero debt, right? We're weaning ourselves off the diocesan support. And I think we're a little bit of growth program when we get that done. I think our biggest asset is the commitment of this congregation to the church. I perhaps underestimated that, maybe being a little bit of a pessimist as we were coming out of the pandemic. But when you see the support that we had during the pandemic and as we came out of it, and then the pledge drive that we had last year, I mean, those are just two really, really bold statements about what people think of their church. I think our future is very bright. Our small size is an advantage and also a disadvantage. To thrive, we do need to grow a little bit. And we need to share this special place with others. I think that's kind of our mission anyway, right? And as we do become a little bit larger, we'll be much stronger for years to come. Your vestry, as TJ mentioned, we called TJ to be our rector here a week or two ago. The I's are getting dotted and the T's are getting crossed on that. Nobody is more fired up about the future of this place than TJ. I would say, you know, just thank you so much to the vestry. Megan and Stephanie, together with myself, we're transitioning out. You know, what I think is so neat about this vestry is you watch, we got all together nine or something like that, and they come together and they all come with different talents. And it's so fun to watch those talents get applied to the business of the church and then start to bloom. And I think it's just so fantastic to see them take their talents and focus them into gifts to our church. Greg Cowell and Tracy Smith, Nancy Kinsey and Lori Schoening, Craig Meyer and Nancy Allen, they're gonna stay on, so that's your continuity piece. And then you've got Rita Ash and Jan Carney and Claire Burns, who are gonna be new vestry members. So that's really exciting. Those are great choices, and I'll just tell you, I have a lot of confidence in our organization going forward, and I think it's going to be a really great year.
Thank you again, Rick, and to all of the outgoing vestry for all of their hard work, especially during such a unique and difficult time of the pandemic, too. The fact that we've come out of it the way that we have is really a testament to their diligence and hard work. So thank you. For my point, I'm going to be very brief in terms of the priest in charge slash rector's report. Just to kind of piggyback on what's already been said, the vestry and I have had this conversation about calling me as rector. I've been here for 3 years serving as your priest in charge. After prayer and discernment, I'm happy to accept. Myself, the vestry, and the diocese, we've all verbally agreed, all the numbers have been agreed to and everything. There's just like one minor like language thing that we need to fix tomorrow and then sign it all. But I'm thrilled to be here serving as your rector. And just FYI about the difference between priest in charge versus rector, it's kind of a minor difference. A priest in charge is placed within a congregation technically by the bishop, whereas a rector is called by the vestry. But the big difference really isn't really so much in terms of role or responsibility or authority. That's all the same. It's really in timeline. A priest in charge is in a congregation for a set period of time. And when I came here at the beginning of 2020 in the pandemic, I was here for a 3-year contract. Now that I'm being called into a new position as your rector, there is no definitive endpoint. Right? So we are entering into a new era of relationship, which I'm very excited.
Yay!
All the other ministry boards who have all done a phenomenal amount of work over this past year, and honestly the last several years, their reports are in our workbook, I guess. Not really workbook, but outline. So I'll let you read those at your discretion. Just for sake of time, we're not going to go through each individual one, just to keep things kind of concise. The last kind of point of business is the election of our new, new vestry and our delegates. So as Rick already mentioned, we have 3 new people who are on the slate of candidates for our vestry. So Megan, Rick, and Stephanie are rotating off because their 3 years have concluded. Thank you guys again for your service. And we're going to say a whole prayer for them in a little bit, so we can applaud them. And on the slate, we have Claire Burns, we have Jen Carney, and Rita Ash. For our delegates to convention, the diocesan convention that happens once a year, we have Rita Ash, Megan Wiles, Nancy Kinsey, and as our alternates, in case one of them is ill or not able to attend, we have Nancy Allen. We have a motion to elect the slate of candidates as presented. So moved by Greg. Is there a second? So moved by Rick. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Wonderful. Moving right along on this. This is great. And so finally, I want to say a brief prayer of thanksgiving for all the members of the vestry who are rotating off, and also a prayer of blessing for all of those who are rotating on, for all of their work and all the work to come. So please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the work and witness of your servants who have enriched this community by offering their wisdom and leadership. Now bless and preserve them as they continue to serve you in new ways. Guide them in the continued use of your gifts. Give them sustenance for temporal and spiritual needs and a clear vision of the ministry to which you now call them. By your Holy Spirit, be present in their pilgrimage, that they may travel with the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And a prayer for our oncoming vestry members. O eternal God, the foundation of all wisdom and the source of all courage, enlighten with your grace the wardens and vestry of this congregation, and so rule their minds and guide their counsels, that in all things they may seek your glory and promote the mission of your church, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
That concludes the business of the annual meeting. Is there a motion to adjourn the meeting to continue on with worship? You are so fast to raise your hand.
Yes.
Dick made a motion to adjourn the meeting. Is there a second? Janet has made a second. Is all in favor?
Aye.
So moved. Thank you all for everything that you do to make this community the wonderful place that it is. Now, let's continue on with the real work of the church, which is our worship. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Father, In your infinite love, you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. The night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink, and new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. In the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask for your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Behold the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Look mercifully on this your family, Almighty God, that by your great goodness they may be governed and preserved evermore. In the name of God the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.